In this video, you will learn how you can create and use an EFS file system with multiple EC2 instances simultaneously. For this, you should of course have a general understanding of what EC2 and EFS is all about and what AWS in general is all about. And in case you're not 100% sure yet, you can get started with AWS and get a solid understanding and a solid overview of all its key services with my AWS Cloud Practitioner course, which will also help you pass your first entry-level AWS certification, in case you're interested. So, for this video, our goal is to have an EFS-managed file system and use it with multiple EC2 instances simultaneously. Because that's the idea behind this EFS service. It is a service that allows you to create managed, scalable file systems that can be used by multiple processes, multiple EC2 instances, for example, simultaneously. Now, we create such a file system via the EFS service page, for example, or through the CLI or whatever. But before we do that, we should actually go back to the EC2 service page and there to the security groups area. Now, as you know, or should know, security groups are firewalls, you could say, that can be attached to EC2 instances. Well, turns out that you cannot just use them with EC2 instances though. Instead, you can also use them, and you should use them, with EFS file systems. So those file systems also receive a security group to manage access to these file systems, to control which kinds of requests can reach those file systems. Therefore, as a first step, we should create a new security group. We can name it EFS demo, for example. It can be attached to the default VPC here, that's okay. And then we should add an inbound rule. And the inbound rule I want to add here is that I want to allow SSH traffic from anywhere because I plan on adding this security group to both my EC2 instances and to my EFS file systems. And for the EC2 instances, I want SSH access. We could also create separate security groups, and that would actually be preferable, but here, to keep things a bit simpler, I'll create one single security group for both my instances and the EFS file system. Now, I'll create that security group and give it a short description, and right after creating it, I'll go back to editing the inbound rules. Because I want to add a second rule, and I deliberately did not do that when I created this security group. Because this second group here is about NFS traffic, which is this network file system traffic that is used for talking to the EFS file system. And I want to allow this kind of traffic as well, since I do plan on adding this security group to my EFS file system. However, I add this rule in a second step because as a source for the traffic, I will actually choose custom, click in here, and then select my EFS demo security group as a source. This essentially translates to a rule which allows this kind of traffic from any device that has this security group attached to it. And that will be my EC2 instance that has this security group attached to it. If I would have created a separate security group for EC2 instances that contains this SSH traffic rule, I would have chosen that identifier of that separate group. Here, since it's one and the same group, I chose this group's identifier. And this now means that only devices that have this security group attached to them can talk to EFS file systems that also have this security group attached to them. With that prerequisite out of the way, we can go to the EFS service page. And there, we want to create a new file system. Now, you can give this any name of your choice. And then you could create it in one step, but I'll customize it. And then you got various options for customizing it. You can enable automatic backups. You can make sure that some data is transferred to a different storage tier if it's not being used for 30 days or a different period. This can help you save cost. You can choose for which kind of operation the file system should be optimized, which will affect the pricing, but will give you a file system that then performs better for certain tasks and worse for other tasks. But for this demo here, this does not matter. This is not a deep dive. This is instead about getting started with EFS and EC2. You can also enable encryption or disable it, whatever you want. Here, I'll disable it to keep things simpler, and then choose Next. And that's now a very important page here, because here we configure so-called mount targets, which in the end is simply a page where we control for which VPC and which subnets in that VPC this file system should be available. Now, we could make it available for all the subnets in that VPC, so for all the availability zones, in this case, therefore. And in case you're not sure what VPCs are, again, in my AWS course, I do explain all these concepts from the ground up. But here for this demo, I'll actually get rid of all mount targets, except for maybe two, let's say. And I'll replace the security group with my EFS demo group. That's the group we created a couple of minutes ago. And that's very important because this group contains the access rules I want to use here. So with these mount targets configured, we can click Next. Now we could actually also add a policy where we can control file access permissions on that file system, also in a very granular way. But here I will allow full access to all the files to everyone who's able to send valid requests to this file system. And then we can confirm this and create the file system. So that's the first step. And it's important to understand that just as with EBS volumes, about which I also created a video, you can create those file systems and you do create those file systems independently from EC2 instances. So you can connect them to EC2 instances thereafter, but you create them in a standalone way. So you create them without creating an EC2 instance at the same time. Instead, that's now the second step. Back here on the EC2 service page, we can launch a new EC2 instance. And here we can keep very simple settings. Use the default AMI, the T2 micro instance type. Proceed without a key pair, because I'll use EC2 instance connect for connecting. And now for the network settings, we must make sure that we choose a subnet and therefore an availability zone that actually gives us access to one of those mount targets we defined a couple of seconds ago for the EFS file system. In my case, I set up mount targets for the availability zones 1B and 1A in that region to which this VPC belongs. And therefore, here, I'll also choose 1A, let's say, for this instance. And for the security group, I'll choose the EFS demo security group, which contains those rules I need. Now, under storage, we want to make sure that a connection is established to this EFS file system and that the EFS file system is usable from inside that instance. This can be done in a very easy way by clicking Edit next to File System. And then click Add Shared File System, and then by selecting that file system we created a few seconds ago. So this file system here. Now we can add a mount point, for example, /demo, which is the folder on the EC2 instance that will be created that then links to that file system. Now here we don't need to automatically create and attach security groups because we did that manually. However, I want to automatically mount the file system because that option gives us a predefined user data script down there. And I do have a separate video about user data if that's brand new to you. But we get this predefined user data, which will basically perform all the steps that must be performed in order to mount and connect this file system to this instance. And now I will launch two instances instead of just one. So here I can choose two instead of just one, so that we get two instances up and running, which both should have access to this file system. And I'm doing this on purpose because a key difference between EBS and EFS is that EFS is really built for and optimized for multi-device access. It's totally normal that multiple devices, multiple workloads work with the same EFS managed file system simultaneously. With EBS volumes, which we created in a different video, you also can have multi-attached volumes, which are used by different instances, but not all instance types support that, and it's definitely not what EBS is optimized for. Instead, with EBS, you manually have to make sure, for example, that data is not clashing if multiple devices use the same volume. With EFS, it's optimized for multi-device or multi-instance, in this case, access. And hence, here, I have these two instances up and running. And now we can connect to the first instance with EC2 Instance Connect. Once the connection is established, we can navigate into this demo folder. And keep in mind that that's the folder that was used for mounting the EFS file system. Now, what I'll do here in this demo folder is I will actually write a test.txt file into this demo folder. You can see it here. And I did this from inside this first instance here. Now, if I select the other instance and I also connect via EC2 Instance Connect there, you will see that there the same file can be seen in the demo folder. Here it is, test.txt. But that's a totally different instance. Nonetheless, this file is there because they're using the same file system, this EFS file system, because it is a shared file system, because that's the core idea behind EFS in the end. It gives us shared, scalable file systems. And that's already it for EFS. Just like EBS, the region matters. As you saw before when I created the mount targets, even the availability zone matters, just as with EBS again, because we must have the instances or the things that should be able to use the file system in the same availability zone as we have mount targets for the file system. Now, with all of that done, I will actually terminate those instances here because I don't need them anymore. And I will also get rid of that file system. For that, we can click into it here and choose delete and then paste in the file system ID here. Whoops, like this. This will delete this file system to make sure that you're not paying for it. Because whilst EFS also is part of the free tier, you want to make sure you don't have any resources lying around which you don't need anymore, because it's just too easy to forget about them and start paying at some point in the future. So therefore, I deleted the file system here and those instances.